Merci. Alors, des émergents aux nouveaux émergents, il n'y a qu'un pas. Sur quel pays peut-on raisonnablement miser sans trop faire d'erreurs? Nous avons choisi d'en mettre deux en avant dans des régions très différentes, la Colombie et l'Indonésie, mais il y en a beaucoup d'autres, on va le voir, qui, malgré la crise ou à la faveur de la crise, ont réussi à tirer leur épingle du jeu au point de devenir de sérieux concurrents. Quelles sont leurs pratiques, quel environnement des affaires et quels risques? Pour y répondre, j'appelle à me rejoindre sur scène Jean-Pierre Lac, conseiller du président du groupe SEB, David Carben, économiste en chef à DBS Bank, basé à Singapour, François Hesbourg, conseiller spécial à la Fondation pour la recherche stratégique. Et tout de suite, pour introduire les débats, une présentation de Mounir Djalil, chef économiste pour la région andine chez Citibank.
Thank you very much, first, for having me here and for inviting me to this discussion. I would love to say that it is an easy discussion just to think that after this set of countries that for many years were just the main topic of conversation, what is exactly worth looking at? I like to think usually as basically what just recently happened since 2007, as a good opportunity for emerging market economies. We received a lot of money that was initially here in our countries just waiting for the worst of the developed world crisis to pass. And well, now that we cannot say it already passed, but that at least we could say the worst, we reached the trough of this cycle has been happening. Well, what is next? So I like to compare the emerging markets picking stories as kind of when you're picking stocks, right? From an academic literature, basically, which is basically granted a Nobel Prize in economics, saying that picking stock doesn't pay. But anyway, there's still a lot of people who still pick the stocks and makes good money. So in the sense of emerging market economies, what should we look at? What are the main characteristics which you concentrate on that definitely will make us believe that a country has potential? In that sense, an unwanted consequence of the dynamics that we observe basically on the inflows of capital is that, and you know this because most of you have to do with risk, is just that, well, now we talk about emerging market economies, but we know we are not all the same. There are different regions, there are different sectors, there are different types of emerging market economies. In the case of Latin America, which is the region where I come from, most of our economies are just commodity producers. So we had a very nice ride between 2007 and 2011 because our terms of trade allow us to have a very nice business cycle. That's the reality of the situation. So, well, it turns out that around 2011, all these terms of trade story came to an end. We have seen ever since either a deterioration or a flattening of the terms of trade of the emerging world. And what's going on next then for these commodity producers' economies? Can we continue to be optimistic on those emerging markets? And that's basically part of the point that I want to try to make. More than providing an answer how to pick an emerging market economy, I just would like you to concentrate on a couple of countries, particularly in Latin America, which have shown resilience in terms of growth. I'm talking about Colombia, I'm talking about Peru. In the picture, basically, you're going to find a behavior of what has been the growth dynamics of many countries between 2009 and 2013. But there, you will only find this one pointing out to the behavior of Colombia and Peru. And in the y-axis, you're going to find also the behavior of, in terms of expected GDP per capita growth, what we at Citi believe will be the per capita growth for 2014. You find, and you also find the dot where basically Latin America currently stands. You find that Colombia and Peru have shown growth that is higher than the Latin American standard, but yes, we're currently, of course, in a situation in which, because of that terms of trade story that I was talking to you before, we are basically experiencing below, I will say, par or normal growth. Both Colombia and Peru have exhibited very nice, very nice growth in GDP per capita. And let me just also show you a little bit of now, if we just concentrate mainly on Latin America. If we see at the behavior of GDP per capita in both of Colombia and Peru, you're going to find that we are below the average GDP per capita in the region. So one main argument why we are basically calling for to take a deeper look at these economies has to do with a convergence story. A convergence story that throughout this whole day I've been hearing about two things that seems to matter a lot. I will add a third, but in just a second. But the first one is infrastructure. We have been just talking about how infrastructure projects are just helping a lot. And we are seeing a lot of projects taking place in both Colombia and Peru. The other one, of course, has to do with institutions and the development of institutions. And throughout the day, we have provided different words for that. We have called that the rule of law in some cases, governance in others. But the situation in the particular case of Colombia and Peru is that we have strong institutions. Yes, in the case of Colombia, we still have I will say, the longest confrontation between rebel groups and any country. We're almost 58 years into that. But the reality of the situation is that institutions in Colombia do work. At this point, I can also say something, for example. There is not a single sector in the Colombian economy, for example, that at this point is saying, you know, I am not able to grow because of the rebels or because of the guerrillas. That at this point, yes, there's still some negotiations going with the rebels, and we hope that we finally reach this peace agreement by 2015, another reason to take a deeper look at the country, because we have been able to decouple the growth story of the country from this project, from this basically behavior of this dynamics, violent dynamics over the past decades. Peru is also a very successful story in terms of growth, but it still doesn't show in terms of GDP per capita. So our hypothesis is that these countries need to continue on track in order to converge, at least to what I say it is just the average GDP per capita of the region, which is around $10,000, $10,900, almost $11,000. So we should look at these countries mainly because it is important to consider this growth story and this growth pattern and the fact that we have to look carefully into it. The other point, which is absolutely important, is that, well, you have to look at sources of growth. Where is growth coming? And the other thing we have heard here repeatedly is that for many emerging market economies, it seems that the growth story has to do with exports. It seems that we, in many emerging market economies, we have not been able to create domestic markets. And in that case, that's something that in the case of Colombia and Peru, that is not the case. Let me put it this way. Colombia is the third largest population in Latin America, 47 million people. If I ask this beforehand, and I tell you what's the third largest economy, nobody will say Colombia. Somebody will say Chile, others will say Argentina. Some others who really know the numbers maybe will even say Venezuela before that. And that's absolutely true. In terms of the size of the economy and the population, there should be a correspondence. It currently doesn't exist for the case of Colombia. Something similar happens to the case of Peru. Peru should be the fourth largest economy, is the fourth largest population. This is not. So there's also there a potential in terms of growth that really matters. We have reached levels of liquidity in our markets that's still low. Of course, this is not Brazil or Mexico in terms of the liquidity of the markets. That's another of the main reasons why this usually, these countries are sometimes overlooked. And just to finish, everybody says I was talking about the external story. This is the behavior of both GDPs in Colombia and Peru. You see that mining in the case of both countries is not the first thing that comes out in terms of creating GDP growth or being part of GDP growth. It's either the fifth or sixth sector. And that's also important because that is telling us that these economies are ready to create domestic growth. We have already seen these economies creating domestic growth. Surprisingly enough, yes, we do need to sell things in order to get dollars from the rest of the world to pay for our imports. But we already have a strong domestic economy. Let me just finish here because this thing, the time already went up. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your presentation, Mounir. Je voudrais d'abord donner la parole à un industriel. Jean-Pierre Lac, SEB en tant que leader mondial de ce qu'on appelle le petit équipement domestique, propose des articles à la vente dans plus de 150 pays. Vous êtes un observateur privilégié de l'émergence d'une nouvelle classe, de nouvelles sociétés vers la société de consommation. Comment sélectionnez-vous les pays où vous implantez et lesquels parmi ceux-là mettriez-vous en avant dans ce qu'on pourrait appeler les nouveaux émergents?
D'accord. Peut-être je commencerai par un propos liminaire moi, pour juste expliquer à tout le monde ce qu'a été le fait stratégique et économique du groupe SEB. Des entreprises comme SEB, Moulinex à son époque, De'Longhi, Philips, ont progressé sur la phase d'équipement des ménages dans les pays matures comme l'Europe et les États-Unis. Bon, cette phase d'équipement est maintenant terminée et nous passons à une phase plutôt d'innovation, de produits design, de marques un petit peu iconique, voilà un peu ce qu'est notre métier. Les pays émergents, c'est précisément l'endroit où va se passer, où se passe ce qui s'est passé en Europe et aux États-Unis après la Deuxième Guerre mondiale. Donc c'est pour ça que les actionnaires et les dirigeants de SEB, au cours des années 90, ont commencé leur offensive vers les pays émergents, et ça a été le Brésil, la Colombie dont on parlera. Et au cours des années 2000, nous avons poursuivi cet effort. Bon, simple petit chiffre, en 2002, SEB, c'était 25% de chiffre d'affaires dans les pays émergents, et c'était très essentiellement deux des BRICS, qui étaient le Brésil et la Russie. Aujourd'hui, c'est 50% dans ces pays émergents, soit 30% parmi ces 50% sont faits dans les BRICS. Les CIVETS, dont on reparlera tout à l'heure, Colombie, Indonésie, and so on, représentent 5%. Si vous voulez, on a diversifié notre risque en matière de pays émergents. Alors, qu'est-ce qui nous fait aller dans tel ou tel pays? La première chose, on espère trouver un niveau de vie minimum, mais qui peut progresser, une solvabilité minimum, ça c'est certain également. Bon, on espère aussi trouver une situation géopolitique sécurisée. Là, Yves en parlait un petit peu tout à l'heure. Aussi, une distribution organisée. Qui dit distribution organisée? Eric Orsena l'a mentionné. Un système de transport qui fonctionne. Par exemple, en Chine, on trouve une distribution organisée qui se développe énormément parce qu'il y a des autoroutes qui ont été faites à des moments où il n'y avait que des petits lapins qui couraient dessus. Voilà. Donc, ils ont fait les choses avant, ce qui n'est pas le cas de l'Inde. Bon, enfin, pour nous, bien entendu, on est une société qui vise quand même à réaliser des résultats, on cherche à pouvoir prendre une part de marché significative assez rapidement. Donc voilà en gros là, ce que sont les raisons qui nous font aller dans tel ou tel pays, et il y a encore beaucoup à faire.
David Carbon, what would you say are the most promising countries in emerging Asia, and would you say it's a process whether it's just catching up with the BRICS, or are there different reasons to believe in the future of these countries?
Well, the biggest reason to believe in the future is the past, maybe. We've had 65 years of really strong growth in Asia. It's the same story over and over, same story, different players, starting with Japan, moving on to Singapore, Hong Kong, moving on to Korea, Taiwan, moving on to Malaysia, then to Thailand, then to China, Vietnam, India, and so on. So it's the same story over and over, different players. When you ask what's the most promising, they're all promising. A lot of times people ask what's the best country to be investing in. That's the thing about Asia. There's a complete rainbow of countries, a complete range of countries. You've got the high income, low growth countries, Japan, Singapore, Hong Kong, and so on. You've got medium income, higher growth countries, Korea, Taiwan. You've got lower income, higher growth countries, Thailand, China, and so on, Vietnam, India, and so on. So you've got the whole range from the top to the bottom, fast growth but low income down here, high income, slow growth up here, and less risk, high risk over here. So you've got the whole range there, and it's just this constant progression of one country nipping at the heels of the country, one rung up the ladder, if you want to call it that, in terms of technology and income levels. This guy's nipping at this guy's heels. He's trying to eat his cake. He's trying to nip at his heels. He's trying to eat his cake, and so on, up the ladder you go. So they're all promising. They're all at different stages of development. They're all at completely different income levels. Singapore, Hong Kong, up here at per capita GDP higher than the U.S. now. Move it down, you know, all the way down from 50,000 down to 23, 24 for Korea, Taiwan. Move it down to 12 to 14 for Malaysia. Move it down to 6,000 per person for China. Move it down to 1,500 for Philippines, and so on. So it's the complete range across the whole spectrum.
Speaking of the fastest growing economies, do they have anything in common? Do they follow common patterns that make them easy to identify?
Well, I think they do. I mean, it's when I say it's the same story over and over, it starts out with a low-income country. You bring in some capital, your wages are extremely low, you can manufacture things very cheaply and join the global economy and put your wares out there, and you can grow very rapidly. Your wages start to go up. When your wages start to go up, your growth rates start to go down. Another country will enter the spectrum, and it's just this repeat over and over and over and over again, which has been going on.
But at this stage, do you see any common point between, say, Vietnam and Indonesia?
Well, they're very close. They're very similar in terms of income levels, in terms of growth rates. Vietnam happened to be, in terms, if you talk about Asia, was a little bit of an outlier over the past 5 years or so. Vietnam was sort of marching to its own beat, and everybody else was, I would say, marching to a more Asia-wide beat. Vietnam got a little bit overheated, and inflation took off, the current account deficit took off, and so on. In that sense, Vietnam looks a little bit like India does today, although India is much, much, much bigger.
François Hesbourg, c'est un peu la même question que je voulais vous poser. Quels sont les pays auxquels il faut s'intéresser, d'après vous, et y a-t-il des points communs ou des raisons communes qui expliquent leur performance aujourd'hui?
Bon, d'abord, il ne faut pas que nous fassions les prisonniers du schéma des BRICS. Les BRICS étaient certes très différents les uns des autres, mais ils avaient au moins quelques points de commun. Ils faisaient tous partie des 10 pays les plus peuplés et les plus grands et économiquement les plus puissants de la planète. Il n'y a aucune unité de ce type-là entre les 160 et quelques pays dont nous sommes en train de parler en ce moment, hein, qui vont depuis le micro-pays jusqu'à l'Indonésie. Hein, vous avez toute la gamme. Alors, qu'est-ce qui fait le succès et qu'est-ce qui fait le non-succès? Et ça, et j'écoutais justement ce qui vient d'être dit sur l'Asie et que l'on retrouve en partie en Amérique latine, et c'est la combinaison de trois facteurs et demi, si je puis dire. Les trois premiers, Eric Orsena en a mentionné, la démographie, bien sûr, il vaut mieux être en transition démographique, ne pas y être. Mais vous noterez aussi que, pour parler un instant anglais, one country's demographic sweet spot is another country's youth bulge. C'est-à-dire la transition démographique de la Thaïlande ne produit pas exactement les mêmes effets que la transition démographique de la Tunisie. Et on retrouve là les deux autres facteurs. La gouvernance notamment en matière de règne du droit et en termes de dépatrimonialisation de l'économie. Les deux choses allant ensemble. Et enfin, la sécurité. On n'en a peut-être pas suffisamment parlé, mais là, la bonne nouvelle depuis une vingtaine d'années, marginaliser l'épouvante que vous voyez quotidiennement à la télévision, dans les endroits où ça va vraiment très mal, vous allez en Syrie, vous allez en Libye, que sais-je, et le fait est que les conflits sont moins nombreux aujourd'hui qu'ils l'étaient il y a 20 ans, qu'ils sont moins meurtriers, et que ceci est vrai à la fois des conflits interétatiques et des conflits intra-étatiques. Et c'est une partie de l'explication de ce qui s'est passé et de ce qui se passe. Alors, je disais 3,5 facteurs. Le demi-facteur, c'est la part que peuvent peser les matières premières, minérales ou énergétiques dans l'économie des pays considérés. On a parlé dans le panel sur l'Afrique de la malédiction des matières premières. Cette malédiction, elle est double. Elle a un effet d'éviction sur les activités agricoles et industrielles par appréciation excessive de la monnaie, mais elle a aussi et surtout un effet généralement catastrophique sur la qualité de la gouvernance, et notamment par le biais de la patrimonialisation, là pour le coup, des actifs économiques. Donc, pensez ceci sous forme d'un petit triangle, démographie, gouvernance, sécurité, et comparez les pays les uns aux autres en la matière, et je pense que vous arriverez à des résultats, à des premières ébauches qui ne seront pas mauvaises comme guide pour vos propres réflexions et pour votre action. Et puis ensuite, bien sûr, les éléments de granularité plus fine dont on a parlé, qualité des infrastructures et ainsi de suite. Mais ce sont vraiment là, pour moi, c'est ça le triangle de fer qui explique le fait de savoir pourquoi est-ce que la Colombie, ça marche, pourquoi le Venezuela, ça ne marche pas.
Do you think this analysis fits the case of Colombia, Munir Jalil? If we look at the situation in terms of security with recent improvements, although, of course, the situation is far from perfect as we speak, if we look at the situation in terms of oil exports as well and dependence on mineral resources, what would be your analysis and what are the main criteria to gauge the strength of the Colombian economy and to consider that Colombia is now joining, if it hasn't joined the BRICS yet, it can be considered as a new emerging economy?
Sure, those are very important factors. Let me begin with the oil, because even if you ask Main Street Colombia what's the most important product of export, it's still going to tell you it's coffee. Coffee represents 3% of our exports nowadays. So it's nothing. It's less than $2 billion. However, when we talk about oil, that's 55% of our exports. And this is new. This is even new for Colombia. It's a new reality. So you're right to touch about that. Yes, it is the most important product of export, and not only that, the United States is the most important client of that oil. So it matters because of two reasons. We have heard about this idea, which the United States is incorporating at a very high speed, its own production of oil. So what's going to happen with our production of oil after 2025, which is supposed to be the year at which the United States could reach or will not need more Colombian oil, it's also a point that matters. Colombia nowadays is able to produce 1 million barrels of oil, 1 million barrels per day of oil. We are currently expecting that in the years to come, Asian economies are going to gain a higher importance now that they're the fourth, fifth trade partner of Colombia. So we are expecting that at due point, we still be able to produce that 1 million barrel per day. We're not going to be able to increase that to two. That's the other reality. So we're able to keep it at that level, but not to increase it, which is good and is bad. Some of you were mentioning before this idea of the curse. So it has been just in the right good amount. It's just 1 million, so that it's not two or three, then it really destroys the rest of the economy. So we believe it's good so that we are going to continue to get some dollars from that oil, but we're not going to be able to affect the rest of the economy as much as it has happened in countries like Venezuela, for example.
Infrastructure is also an issue and still requires major improvements.
Yes, the infrastructure, because of the conflict, has been terrible. I mean, we have not seen investments in, for example, roads, at least in the past 30 years, because in 30 years you were not able to take a road to move from one city to the other. Well, that was great for the local airline companies, but because now we do move. We still now we have the culture that even if it's 20 minutes away, we take a plane instead of taking the car. But now we can take the car. That's the good news. However, we do need to do significant investments, and those are finally turning into reality after many years in which we were the ones saying, hey, you know, this is not going to turn into a reality. For the first time, we're really seeing that now, 2014 and 2015, through a concession program that we implemented 2 years ago, we're finally going to see some of these concessions, and that's going to help in the short term GDP growth, and in the medium to long term, it's just competitiveness, basically, that we're getting into when we're doing that.
Jean-Pierre Lac, l'expérience de SEB en Colombie, vous pouvez nous en parler en quelques mots?
Oui, tout à fait. C'est un pays que nous aimons bien, dans lequel nous sommes arrivés, je dirais, un petit peu par hasard en 1997, lorsque nous faisions l'acquisition d'une société au Brésil. Il se trouve qu'un vendeur de sa société, et le nom ne s'invente pas parce qu'il s'agit d'une société qui s'appelait Samouraï en Colombie, nous a vendu cette société en 1997. Et nous avons vécu tout ce que vous avez expliqué, c'est-à-dire la progression de la Colombie, ses vicissitudes, à tel point qu'en 2011, nous avons décidé d'acheter une autre société qui était localisée à Medellín. Il fallait oser, mais enfin, bon, on l'a fait. Ça se passe très bien, c'est Imusa. Et la Colombie, c'est pour nous les 47 millions d'habitants que vous mentionnez. C'est une certaine influence sur les pays avoisinant, c'est le 11e pays du groupe en termes de chiffre d'affaires. Nous y faisons pratiquement 100 millions d'euros de chiffre d'affaires. Donc c'est un pays que l'on aime bien et sur lequel on compte pour notre futur.
Another country you mentioned in your presentation, Peru, has just like Colombia signed a host of free trade agreements with NAFTA countries. Would you say that the openness of a country's economy is definitely a sign of its ability to join the new emerging class of countries?
I believe it is definitely a step in the right direction. However, the reality of the situation, when somebody asks about that, mainly locals, they do expect that after signing a free trade agreement, it's just manufacturing that we're going to be selling to these countries, and of course that's not the case. We do expect a reshuffling of what are we buying, who are we buying from after these free trade agreements, that's for sure. But I guess the main point for commodity producing countries is differentiation. Now, we have to accept our reality. We're not going to be producing iPods, we're not going to be producing these berries. That's not the case for Colombia. But maybe through differentiation, we're able to sell, as we have this idea of the very nice coffee. Well, why not replicate that and get some sense more for everything that we try to produce in terms of agricultural exports or that type of. So I think it's a marketing idea. We need a lot of to move in that direction, to get a lot of sanitary permits and to be able to sell goods with agricultural value added. But let me just put it this way. Chile has been successfully able to do it, and we think we are able to follow that story as well.
La diversification de l'économie. On a aussi parlé du contexte politique. Je voulais vous interroger là-dessus, François Hesbourg, parce qu'on a le cas avec la Colombie et le Pérou, de deux pays qui ont un passé tourmenté. Bon, dans le premier, évidemment, avec la situation des FARC et les négociations qui sont actuellement en cours avec les autorités pour parvenir à un cessez-le-feu durable. Elles ont lieu à Cuba en ce moment. Et puis, dans le cas du Pérou, on a tous en mémoire le souvenir du Sentier Lumineux et puis du mouvement Tupac Amaru, à qui d'ailleurs le président Fujimori doit entre autres sa réputation de président inflexible. Il y a toujours un risque sécuritaire qui existe aujourd'hui dans ces deux pays, d'après vous?
Il y a un risque sécuritaire, mais il est maîtrisé. Dans le cas de la Colombie, on est très très loin aujourd'hui de la situation d'il y a 15 ou 20 ans, où non seulement il y avait une insécurité massive dans les campagnes, l'insécurité criminelle du narcotrafic, on parlait de la ville de Medellín, son cartel et ainsi de suite, et il y avait l'industrie, parce que c'était une industrie de l'enlèvement. qui rendait évidemment assez difficile le travail des investisseurs étrangers, parce qu'ils préféraient ne pas allonger leur séjour excessivement pour le cas où ils se rendraient dans ce pays. Ça, c'est fini, ça.
C'est le Mexique aujourd'hui
le problème. Le Mexique, vous avez des situations très graves liées au narcotrafic dans certaines régions. Mais lorsque vous regardez les bilans humains d'une année sur l'autre, vous êtes dans des situations qui ne sont pas très différentes de celles que les États-Unis, par exemple, ont connues lors du pic de la criminalité, liée d'ailleurs à la démographie de l'époque, des années 70 et des années 80. Au Mexique, vous avez un rythme d'assassinat qui n'est pas extravagant. Si vous cherchez des rythmes d'assassinat extravagants, vous allez au Guatemala, vous allez au Honduras, vous allez dans certaines villes du Brésil. Mais ce qui m'inquiète le plus aujourd'hui en Amérique latine, ce ne sont pas les situations, j'allais dire, sécuritaires, en dehors des quelques pays ou localités que je viens d'évoquer, ce sont les situations politiques. Car, par exemple, la Colombie, ça va. Il y a une vie politique, démocratique, stabilisée. Pour employer un mot un peu galvaudé, une vie politique normale. Et au Pérou, on n'y est vraiment pas. Pas encore. Et il y a plusieurs pays d'Amérique latine, et pas besoin de regarder le Venezuela, où on ne peut pas dire aujourd'hui qu'il y ait une vie démocratique et républicaine stabilisé. L'Argentine, par exemple, pour moi, reste, de ce point de vue-là, un sujet de préoccupation. Donc, il ne faut pas simplement s'attacher à la question de la sécurité, il faut bien s'attacher à la question de la gouvernance. En Argentine, vous aviez des problèmes de sécurité ou d'insécurité il y a 30 ans, vous n'avez plus aujourd'hui. Par contre, en ce qui concerne la règne du droit, il y a sans doute ici des représentants de quelques sociétés qui ont eu des problèmes en Argentine en matière de règne du droit au cours des 20 dernières années.
Justement, la Colombie et l'autre pays dont on va parler dans un instant, l'Indonésie, entre tous deux en année électorale cette année, quelles vont être les répercussions? Doit-on en attendre des répercussions particulières sur le climat des affaires?
Écoutez,
compte tenu de ce qu'on attend évidemment
des élections en Colombie seront très vraisemblablement des élections normales. Bien sûr, ça dépendra du programme, de l'un et de l'autre, de la façon dont le programme sera appliqué, mais ce ne sera, à mon sens, ni plus ni moins qu'un combat électoral apaisé dans une démocratie raisonnablement apaisée. En Indonésie, vous avez une interférence entre la vie politique et la réaction de la société par rapport à la corruption massive. Et là, ça risque d'être nettement plus compliqué, encore que, qui est-ce qui aurait dit il y a 30 ans que le pays musulman le plus peuplé du monde, l'Indonésie est un pays musulman, qui s'étale sur des millions de kilomètres carrés, éclatés en des milliers d'îles et ainsi de suite, a priori ingouvernable sans une main de fer, et à l'époque il y avait une main de fer, que ce pays, depuis maintenant 15 ans, vit une vie démocratique, bon, certes un peu chaotique, un peu bordélique, pour parler trivialement, mais somme toute, si vous me demandez, est-ce que la vie des entrepreneurs étrangers va changer fondamentalement après les élections en Indonésie, la réponse courte, j'étais un peu long, mais j'arrive à la réponse courte, qui est non.
David Carbon, what's your analysis of the political situation in Indonesia with this upcoming presidential election?
Oh, it's an issue in terms of popular sentiment. There's a big issue with respect to wages. There's a big issue with respect to fuel subsidies. Both of these, to me, I think are problems for growth in the longer term, but they're small problems. The basic story of Indonesia post-97, post the crisis, which we had 96, 97, and so on, Suharto left, has been a very strong rebuilding of legal foundations, of institutions. The tax structure is much better. The investment framework is much better. They're making lots of slow, steady progress here ever since 97. There are these issues. I mean, when elections come up, people want high minimum wages. Well, everybody wants a high minimum wage, you know, but it gets in the way. It's not a big problem. It's a short-term problem. For Asia, generally, I mean, these things are small compared to the fact that Asia today is big. And Asia today drives its own growth, and Asia today generates so much of its own domestic demand, which fuels its own growth, that these small things which get in the way, frankly, are really, really small. Think about it today, where Asia is and what it has done in the last 5 years. If you go back to 2008, pre-Lehman Brothers, before Lehman Brothers broke up, what did you read on the front page of the Financial Times every day? What did you read on the front page of the Wall Street Journal every day? What you read was that the U.S. drove global growth, and the U.S. consumer drives global growth. And if that U.S. consumer ever dies, you know, Asia was going to die a death worse than the U.S. Because the U.S. consumer bought everything, and Asia didn't buy anything. All Asia did was produce and sell to the West, and Asia ran these great big surpluses. The U.S. ran these great big deficits. And if the U.S. consumer ever died, Asia would die a death twice as bad. We got the perfect test of that. In September 2008, Lehman Brothers went over the hill, and the U.S. consumer did die. In the 4 or 5 years since Lehman Brothers went over the hill, it took the U.S. about 4 years just to get back to square one, so 4 years of no growth. In the 4 years following that, Japan has had zero growth. In the 4 years since Lehman Brothers, Europe has had negative growth, right? During this 4 year time frame following Lehman Brothers, Asia continued to move up and up and up and up to do exactly what everybody said it could never ever do. How much, what has it done? Let me put some numbers out here. In the 4 years following Lehman Brothers, Asia put a whole Germany on the map, okay? Added a Germany to the economic map right inside Asia. Asia today is big enough and it's growing fast enough that every 3.5 years today, it puts a whole Germany, boom, someplace in Asia. Okay, every 2.5 years, Asia puts a France someplace in Asia. Okay, it's creating a lot of domestic demand, a lot of dollars of demand. A lot of times we get so distracted by these growth rates, you know, 6%, 7%, nice. But think about the dollars of growth, and sometimes it really knocks you over. Every 2.5 years, Asia's putting a whole France on the map. And this is really important when you think about, you know, the euro and the euro crisis. We talk about what was really going to save the euro was going to be more demand from where? From Germany, right? What we need from Germany is more demand, less current account surpluses. Germany needs to buy more. That is ultimately the test for the euro, whether it's going to survive or not. I'm not so sure about that. You think about how fast can Germany grow and how much demand can it create? It's not that much when you compare it to other parts of the world. Do this little test in your head. Suppose Germany grew at a 1.5% growth rate every year for the next 50 years. What would happen to Germany? It would about double in size. In 50 years, Germany would add a Germany. Today, Asia adds a Germany every 3.5 years, okay? And there's nothing that says that if Europe wants to get out of this euro crisis, that the demand to save Europe has to come from Germany. Why can't it come from Colombia? Why can't it come from Asia? It can come from anywhere. It doesn't have to be Germany. And that's the kind of growth that we're getting today out of Asia. That's the kind of dollars of demand that we're getting. Every 2.5 years, Asia is putting a new France on the map, someplace in Asia.
That's a striking example. Now, you're talking about the whole continent. Like, if we stick to our example, Indonesia, what makes the strength of the Indonesian economy? If we look at the numbers, growth figures since 2010, the Indonesian economy has topped 5% growth every year. It was among the only G20 countries to enjoy a positive economic growth in 2009, a year of crisis pretty much everywhere else in the world. Now, looking at Asia's manufacturing industry, would you say that Indonesian producers and exporters are oriented towards the most dynamic segments of world trade, where there's the highest and the higher potential growth market?
Absolutely. Two points quickly. First, Indonesia is one of the three big countries in Asia, which really wasn't hit very much by the crisis at all. If you draw a picture of GDP in Indonesia from the middle of 2008 to the middle of 2011, a three-year time frame here, just draw a picture of the level of GDP, it was pretty much a straight line. It wasn't like Taiwan or Hong Kong or Singapore, which went like zoom and zoom. Indonesia was pretty much a straight line. So was China. So was India. Now, on these 3 years for Indonesia from the middle of 08, it wasn't just 1 year. It was from the middle of 08 to the middle of 2011. It grew 6% per year, right through what was supposedly the biggest crisis in 100 years. And it did it without the help of the US, it did it without the help of Europe, and it did it without the help of Japan. 3 years, from the front of the crisis to 3 years after the crisis, straight line 6% growth. So it's got its own domestic demand. It can do a lot on its own. Now, the second part of your question is, are their exports important, and are they tapped in to the important parts of the growing world? And they absolutely are. Unfortunately, that means mostly China. You know, it's a very lopsided story for Asia. China is at the center of it, okay? Almost all the countries in Asia, with the exception of India, because India and China have had, you know, traditional political problems and so on, but almost all the other countries of Asia, when you look at where their exports have gone, we pulled a picture out from the dot-com crisis, 2000-2001, and look at where the exports have gone. And you can, almost every single country from 2000 to today, you can draw a straight line for their exports to the US, and you can draw a really sharp upward line for exports to China. For Asia, on average, exports to the US have gone nowhere, and exports to China on this 10-year period have gone up by a factor of 8 to 8.5. For Indonesia, it's even more. It's like a factor of 12. So 12 times growth in exports headed to China vis-a-vis something like the US, where it's basically zero.
Jean-Pierre Lac, l'expérience du groupe SEB en Indonésie, un pays qui présente un certain nombre de particularités, vous m'avez dit.
Ah oui, tout à fait, mais moi, d'abord, l'Indonésie, c'est la deuxième lettre de l'acronyme CIVETS, hein, où on veut être très présent, où on est très présent sur la plupart des autres lettres. Bon, l'Indonésie, c'est, j'ajouterai à tout ça, c'est en plus un pays dans lequel la distribution moderne est bien implantée, donc c'est un pays qu'on devrait adorer. Ben écoutez, ça se passe pas très bien. Alors, c'est peut-être à cause de ce que Yves nous a montré tout à l'heure. Moi, j'ai vu l'Indonésie à l'avant-dernier rang d'un classement où on parle de corruption et de choses comme ça. C'est peut-être ses particularités qui font qu'on n'y réussit pas. Alors, vous pourriez me répondre et me rétorquer que la Russie était derrière l'Indonésie. Je dirais à ça que la Russie, ça fait 25 ou 30 ans qu'on y fait du business. Peut-être qu'on a appris à connaître. Alors, peut-être que l'Indonésie, il va falloir qu'on apprenne à connaître. Et peut-être que le meilleur moyen pour connaître l'Indonésie, c'est peut-être de travailler l'Indonésie et partir de celui qui est juste au-dessus dans le fameux classement, c'est-à-dire la Chine, où nous avons maintenant de fortes bases. Mais bon, l'Indonésie, j'avoue que vous répondiez non, François, là, tout à l'heure, on a un petit peu de mal quand même.
François,
oui, je réponds non, et malheureusement non, parce que j'aurais préféré dire oui, les élections vont faire un vrai changement, parce que la lutte contre la corruption va vraiment pouvoir démarrer. L'Indonésie fonctionne au plan économique en sous-potentiel. 5% par an, c'est certes très bien sur les 15 dernières années, mais ce n'est pas l'Inde et ce n'est pas la Chine. Alors que c'est un État continent qui, de ce point de vue-là, appartient au monde des briques, des États continents, plutôt qu'au tout venant. La corruption et la patrimonialisation d'une bonne partie de l'économie expliquent vraisemblablement ce sous-potentiel. J'ajoute aussi, quand même, pour qu'on soit complet sur le film, l'Indonésie a eu un très très gros hoquet en 1997-1998. Sa crise, elle n'a pas eu lieu en 2008-2009, elle a eu lieu en 1997-1998, ça s'appelait la crise asiatique, et l'Indonésie a été dans le maelstrom du point de vue économique. Et j'appelais tout à l'heure à la nécessité de différencier. La Colombie et l'Indonésie n'appartiennent pas du tout au même monde. La Colombie fait déjà partie de la classe moyenne des nations ou des nations à classe moyenne. L'Indonésie, on n'en est pas tout à fait là. Être prospère en Indonésie, pour l'Indonésien moyen, c'est de pouvoir s'acheter sa mobylette, alors que pour le Colombien, c'est de pouvoir s'acheter sa voiture. C'est ça la différence. Et les problèmes de l'Indonésie sont des problèmes de pays qui est encore en début de décollage. Par contre, dans la région, je parlais de la Thaïlande il y a quelques instants, là vous avez des pays qui sont des pays à problème de classe moyenne. Et il y a quelque chose dont on n'a pas parlé ici aujourd'hui, on avait pas mal parlé à une réunion de ce type de la COFAS l'année dernière. Et c'est l'impact de l'émergence de la classe moyenne. Alors, ce dont on s'aperçoit, c'est que toute une série des pays nouveaux émergents sont des pays qui sont en train de faire leur mai 68. La Thaïlande, la Turquie, le Brésil, l'Ukraine, avec des caractéristiques très différentes. Hein, le parallèle avec mai 68 est très imparfait, sauf à un niveau, c'est que vous avez effectivement les classes moyennes ou les enfants des classes moyennes qui descendent dans la rue et qui se castagnent avec les keufs. Hein, ça a un impact économique. Hein, j'ajoute tout de suite, en Indonésie, vous avez 300 000 touristes de moins au cours des trois derniers mois. Ça a une incidence sur l'activité économique. La Turquie, le ralentissement de l'activité économique turque n'est certes pas causé par les événements qui se sont déroulés et qui se déroulent aujourd'hui dans ce pays, mais ces événements n'aident pas. Donc ça aussi, c'est quelque chose à intégrer. Je me risque à une analogie qui est peut-être fausse, mais qui doit provoquer en tout cas la réflexion, c'est que la révolte des classes moyennes dans les pays d'Europe et d'Amérique du Nord à la fin des années 60, ont été le prélude au ralentissement de la croissance dans les 5 ou 6 années qui ont suivi. Il n'y a pas de lien de causalité, du moins pas évident, mais il y a une corrélation chronologique. Donc j'appelle à réfléchir un tout petit peu à ce parallèle.
Could you react to this, Mounir Jalil? What's your reaction to the emergence? First of all, would you say that there is actually the emergence of a middle class that's substantive in Colombia? And what's the impact of this middle class on the economy? Is it a new engine to domestic growth by fueling consumption? Does it also create possibly a further obstacle to future growth in the future? Does it mean that growth at some point will sort of reach a certain level and stop growing as fast as it has over the past few years?
For the first part of the question, the answer is yes. We have seen definitely by all the metrics, there has been at least a transition in the last 5 years of 1.5 million families who were considered poor now are considered middle class. And as basically, as he was pointing out just a second, now we see an increased demand of all type household appliances. Now it's not the very small things, it's just the big ones. And we can see that definitely in the country. Now in the case of cars, everybody wants a car, that's true. Now we don't have the roads where to put those cars, but still people want the cars. That the first part of the answer is yes, that will propel growth, that will create aggregate demand, that will help domestic consumption, is going to be great with that. And if we couple that a little bit with infrastructure in terms of roads, well, where to put those cars, that's going to be just fine. But your second part of the question is a tricky one and the most difficult one, because you're saying, okay, are we going to have a similar situation to the one already experienced by some of those big countries? And the answer is we hope not, but there are a lot of similarities. At some point on the ladder, when wages do get, when people start asking for improvements in the life of quality of life, we could see some of that reaction. It's something we cannot deny. However, that's when the government, I think, will have to get in before this happens in order to make a better redistribution of wealth so that we avoid that type of question. So a better tax structure, for example, will definitely help in order to try to not to replicate. That's the lesson as a country that we have to learn from this social unrest we have seen in other parts of the world.
David Carbon, do you agree with François Heisbourg when he's saying that Indonesia is not yet at this stage where it can claim a significant middle class?
It's getting there. I mean, I don't really know what a middle class is, you know? I mean, you have to define it. Everybody's income is going up, Indonesia's included. Now, its per capita income is $3,500. China's is $6,000. Malaysia's is $12,000 or $13,000. Everybody has a middle class. I mean, there's more and more and more private apartments going up in Jakarta. It's becoming actually a nightmare in a lot of ways for traffic and so on. But consumption is going up. It's as incomes go up, people want what richer countries have, and that's, you know, it's just normal.
Jean-Pierre, votre expérience à vous des classes moyennes, comment est-ce que vous les est-ce que vous êtes confronté parfois aussi à des problèmes d'incompréhension qui peuvent être culturels?
Bien sûr. D'une part, sur les classes moyennes, y compris dans les BRICS, moi, quand on parle du Brésil, il y a cette émergence de la classe qu'on appelle la classe C, en particulier dans le nord-est du pays, à laquelle, justement, on essaie de s'adresser avec des différences sur les produits, parce que ce n'est pas les mêmes produits que ceux qui se consomment à Saint-Paul ou ailleurs. Bon, voilà, donc il y a des choses de ce type-là. Bon, quant à aux divergences...
Il y a un appétit pour l'innovation et pour les oui, nouvelles technologies plus prononcées, presque.
Oui, absolument. Mais ça, c'était aussi le cas de la Colombie, on voit progresser beaucoup plus vite que ne l'ont fait les pays matures vers les produits d'innovation. Vous voyez, on vend des friteuses sans huile, même en Colombie. On vend des friteuses sans huile, mais vraiment beaucoup en Turquie, où ils en font des usages fantastiques. Bon, mais si vous voulez, ils arrivent beaucoup plus vite à l'innovation que l'Europe n'elle-même n'y est arrivée. Absolument. Donc ça, ce sont les classes moyennes. Et on le voit en Chine, bien évidemment, où on parle de classe moyenne pour 300 millions de personnes, mais chaque année s'ajoute une France de classe moyenne en Chine.
We have less than 5 minutes left. There was just one last question that I wanted to talk with both David and Munia. If we try to look forward and think about what will happen if the Fed pulls back on its stimulus program, what will be the impact on Latin American economies?
Sure. That's a great question. Definitely, most of our economies in Latin America are commodity-based. And when we had this tremendous amount of liquidity sent out, it created inflation in all assets. It's not only commodities, but commodities was one particular class of assets that suffered of that inflation. So now that we know that, yes, this is happening, of course, it should matter a little bit for our terms of trade. So we are not expecting our terms of trade to really improve. Putting it this way, if we're thinking of what are the boosters of growth going forward, it cannot be from external. It cannot be from commodities. Having said that, we also are not expecting a big reduction in exports, either because we will compensate through volumes, or we're losing a little bit of price. So the amount of dollars that we will continue selling to the rest of the world is going to remain constant. But the effects in terms of the price of what we're selling will be there. We will also have some effects on our interest rates, because these announcements will also affect interest rates of our own local curves. We will have local debt everywhere. That's kind of the big difference between the 80s and now. In the 80s, we were full of external debt. Now we're full of local debt. But instead of having then issues with getting the dollars to repay the debt, now what we will see is an increasing local interest rates. That has to happen. I will say those two will be the most important consequences we will face in Latin America.
David, what about the exchange rate risk with Indonesia? Recent months have shown just how vulnerable the rupiah is on U.S. monetary policy decisions.
Yeah, when the Fed first started talking about tapering, everybody got hit a little bit, and the speculators, where are you going to attack? You're going to attack current account deficit countries. For Asia, that was India, and secondly, it was Indonesia. Indonesia is slightly in deficit, and they've basically come back to balance. It's kind of unfortunate. I mean, I understand it, but it's unfortunate in the sense that for so long, all the developed countries have been telling Asia, you shouldn't be running these surpluses. And frankly, it makes sense from a country perspective and from a foreign investor perspective. You don't want the poorer countries running surpluses. You want them running deficits, right? If you're running a deficit, you're borrowing from somebody else. If you're running a surplus, you're lending to somebody else. You don't want the poor countries lending to the rich countries. You want the rich countries lending to the poorer countries. That means Asia should be running deficits. Asia should not be running surpluses. This, from the perspective of the Asian country itself and from the perspective of the foreign investor. If the foreign investor is trying to put his money, take his money out of his own country and put it someplace else, where do you do it? You put it where there's less capital, where the returns are higher, and you do it with a country which needs to borrow it. You know, if you're running a deficit, there's no point in, if you're running a surplus, there's no point in borrowing money from abroad. You're already lending money. You can't be borrowing it back in again. So from the perspective of both the country and the foreign investor, it makes sense for the poorer countries to be running deficits and the richer countries to be running surpluses. And we shouldn't be afraid for deficits for that reason. That's the whole point. Right?
Just one very last question. When we look at countries in Southeast Asia, they're all, of course, related to some extent to Chinese economic cycles. Does this make them vulnerable at all?
Well, China is certainly the big driver. I mean, go back to what I said before about every 3 years or 3.5 years, Asia puts a Germany on the map. Where is that demand coming from? 2/3 of it is coming from China, so it is very lopsided. And it's getting more lopsided, not less lopsided, because China has the biggest base and it's growing the fastest. So the amount of demand that it's generating, it's going to become more and more lopsided over time in terms of who this is generating. Now we call that, we put a little quip on it, we call it new drivers, new risks. Asia is driving the global economy. China is driving the Asian economy. If you've got new drivers, it's the flip side of the same coin. You've got new risks. So it's absolutely correct that now, if you used to keep one eye on the U.S., now you keep 1.5 eyes on China and 1/2 an eye on the U.S.
This will be our final word. Thank you, David Carbon, for being with us. Merci, Jean-Pierre Lac. Merci, Mounir Djalil. François Hibault, vous restez avec nous pour la prochaine table ronde. Merci.